Let's enter into worship this morning with our opening song, number 3140. It is in the green, thin hymnal. Please stand if you are able and let's sing.
Please join me in the call to worship. God calls to the lost, the least, and all who long for home.
God calls when we wander from the path chosen for us and waste the gifts we have been given.
God calls and welcomes us back to worship this day.
Let us celebrate and rejoice in God's presence forever. Let us worship God together.
Let us pray. God, it was said of the prodigal son that he came to himself. Help us to wake up to ourselves and to you. Set us free from the illusion of trying to be perfect so that we might be more fully human. Help us not to chase after an imaginary life and to find satisfaction in our real lives, and turn us away from our self-rejection so that we might see that your arms are open and welcome. Please be seated. The scripture reading today is from Psalm 112. Praise the Lord. How joyful are those who fear the Lord and delight in obeying his commands. Their children will be successful everywhere. An entire generation of godly people will be blessed. They themselves will be wealthy, and their good deeds will last forever. Light shines in the darkness for the godly. They are generous, compassionate, and righteous. Good comes to those who lend money generously and conduct their business fairly. Such people will not be overcome by evil. Those who are righteous will be long remembered. They do not fear bad news. They confidently trust the Lord to care for them. They are confident and fearless and can face their foes triumphantly. They share freely and give generously to those in need. Their good deeds will be remembered forever. They will have influence and honor. The wicked will see this and be infuriated. They will grind their teeth in anger. They will slink away, their hopes thwarted.
Thank you.
22. It is the same version of the story that the children just heard. Jesus said a certain man had two sons. The younger son said to his father, "Father, give me my share of the inheritance." Then the father divided his estate between them. Soon afterward, the younger son gathered everything together and took a trip to a land far away. There he wasted his wealth through extravagant living. When he had used up his resources, a severe food shortage arose in that country, and he began to be in need. He hired himself out to one of the citizens of that country, who sent him into the field to feed his pigs. He longed to eat his fill, what the pigs ate, but no one gave him anything. When he came to his senses, he said, "How many of my father's hired hands have more than enough food, but I'm starving to death? I will get up and go to my father and say, 'Father, I have sinned against heaven and against you. I no longer deserve to be called your son. Take me on as one of your hired hands.' So he got up and went to his father. And while he was still a long way off, his father saw him and was moved with compassion. His father ran to him, hugged him, and kissed him. Then his son said, 'Father, I have sinned against heaven and against you. I no longer deserve to be called your son.' But the father said to his servants, 'Quickly bring out one of the best robes and put it on him. Put a ring on his finger and sandals on his feet. Fetch the fattened calf and slaughter it. We must celebrate with feasting, because this son of mine was dead and has come back to life. He was lost and is found.' And they began to celebrate." Here ends the reading of our scripture. May God bless our hearing. if there's one thing you can count on in the church year, is that in late October or November, what's the topic? Any? Nope, not Christmas yet. Giving, money, stewardship. Stewardship is defined as the job of taking care of something. It's always going to come up at this time of year, so we're going to spend the next couple weeks talking about how our faith connects with our finances, personally and in the church. And this is a hot topic for us as the church. If you don't know, spoiler alert, everything we do here depends on your giving. Our budget is entirely based on what we collectively bring together to do God's kingdom work. And so yes, how we handle our money as Christians is a big part of our faith journey, no matter where you look. Did you know that there are roughly 2,350 verses concerning money in the Bible? That's almost twice as many verses as there are about faith and prayer combined. Now, I've heard some pastors say that Jesus talked more about money than anything else. That's not true. Jesus talked about something else more than anything else, and that's loving your neighbor as yourself. Jesus talked about money about the third of the time. But it is a topic of interest because we all know the price of groceries and gas and housing, and all of that is in the news. Will the economy enter into a full-blown period of inflation? Are we already there? Some of us watch the markets. Markets lately this year have been like this. And you look at one news outlet and the economy is good, and you look at another and it's not so good, and housing costs are out of control, and somewhere along the way, we have to figure out where to look. Where do we go? We need to look at the Bible for some wisdom. Because if you think about it, you and I don't have much control over what the Federal Reserves do, or the markets, or what happens in our government, but we do have control over our personal finances and how we approach them and how we respond to what's going on around us. And that's why we're going to be talking about financial wisdom and courage and peace. And here's one more statistic. The stress in families and in marriages that is the highest and most destructive is the stress over money. When money is tight, or we have disagreements about how to spend what we have, or we worry constantly about how we can afford medical bills or food or gas or rent, life can be pretty miserable. I have a little cred to stand here and speak about this because I have the experience to be able to say that my life has had its own share of financial stress and disasters. Some of my own making. And some that were not mine, but I suffered because of someone else's choices. But I have learned that the Bible clearly has teachings on money, lots of them. And yet we don't feel all that comfortable having conversations about money, but I think we can do hard things. One of the passages we hear quoted a lot, or shall I say misquoted a lot, is that money is the root of all evil. How many of you have heard that? 1 Timothy 6:10, for the love of money is the root of all kinds of evil. Did you hear the difference? For the love of money is the root of all kinds of evil. Some people eager for money have wandered from the faith and pierced themselves with many griefs. This points us back to the Ten Commandments, first one. Do you know what it is? It starts out with thou shalt not. Or you shouldn't, or you shall not, or just don't have any other gods before me. Timothy's talking about making a god of money. We covet money. We put having a lot of it on a pedestal. And we idolize the idea that in order to be successful and achieve the American dream, what is that anyway, except for another god, we have to have a certain amount of money, which is a lot. I think and I believe and I have discerned from Scripture that having a healthy relationship with money and material things stems from having a healthy relationship with God. And it's really, really hard to do. So we're going to dive in together, and hopefully something that you hear in the next couple of weeks will touch your heart or maybe just be some practical advice. Keeping up with the Joneses, or shall I say the Kardashians, for a new generation is still very much alive today. Now, if you have social media on that little computer that we carry around all the time, you might have heard of these things called influencers. Anybody heard of an social media influencer? Okay. Their main job is to sell. They are basically commercials that run constantly in the palm of your hand. And you see one, and I've been looking at them all week. It's not good, but some of them use their personal story of suffering to bring you into their life on social media. And then the next day, they post something about this great product that they have, and they give you a link to it. And you were just curious about what was going on with their small child, because we all have compassion. And so when something pops up and we see it, we want to know more. So you connect with them, and you follow them. And then they post links to their favorites. Remember Oprah's favorite things? That was a phenomenon a decade ago, but now it's Jen's favorite things or Sarah's favorite things, and Christmas lists are big right now. You can get anybody's favorite things online right now. And for some of us, maybe more than we would like to admit, a part of our brain gets activated when we see that stuff online. And we think, me included, that if I don't have that, or if I don't live like that, if I don't go on that trip, maybe my life doesn't measure up. And then some folks extend themselves beyond their means using credit cards. And wow, it gets really crazy out there. But if you're living to get some sort of outside approval, financial disasters can and will happen at some point. Excessive materialism is a big deal if you think about all of those storage sheds that we've had to build lately. That's a business all in itself. So we're going to start with our gospel reading. I think one of the primary struggles that many of us have is that we all have a little bit of the prodigal son in us. The prodigal, the younger of the two sons, demanded his inheritance right away. He didn't want to wait. Then he goes away and he squanders everything. And this parable is a story about God's love, about how God takes us back, about how God's mercy is abundant, how God joyfully welcomes us home even when we have squandered everything. And that's the aspect of the story that we normally focus on. But there's another important element of the story that I want to touch on. As the parable begins, Jesus describes the habits of the young man. First of all, he asks for his share, takes it, leaves to another country, and then spends it all on decadent living. And I think in my version it says, I'll get those later. He says he wasted all his money on parties and prostitutes. Extravagant living. Then he runs out of money and he begs for help. And we see that the son had this habit of squandering and spending. And the word prodigal in Greek, we almost always connect it with lost and wandering. Prodigal means one who wastes money. And many people struggle with this habit as well. The man wanted his inheritance, and he wanted it right now. He could have waited. He would have had income for life. But all he wanted was instant gratification. He wasn't interested in tomorrow, he was interested in right now. And some of us don't want to wait 20 and 30 years to see what our investments look like. We want it right now. Now, the father probably said more to the son than we read into this. He probably begged him not to do this. He probably said, you know what, if you just wait, I've set aside some property for you. You will have an inheritance for life if you just wait. But the son didn't listen. No, the famine will eventually come for all of us who think this way. When we spend everything, when we don't save, the car will break down. There will be medical needs, and we might not have any money left to pay for it. And then we use credit cards, which compounds the problem. So I looked looked back at my Seven Habits book from Stephen Covey. I mentioned it last week. This week, what came up for me was, what is your purpose? What is your mission statement? And then we think about, what is our church's purpose? And what is our church's mission statement? And how are we pooling all of our resources together to fulfill God's mission for the church? It's one question, but it's really two. It's your personal mission statement. And then how is that fulfilling the church's mission statement? Why are you here? Society tells us that we're here to consume. Make as much money as we can. Spend as much money as we can. John Wesley had another saying. Does anybody know? Make all the money you can. Save all the money you can. And give all the money you can. God told Abraham in the Bible that I chose you. I will bless you so that you can bless others. And like Abraham, we are made to be a blessing to others. Generosity is actually a spiritual gift. Our purpose in life is not our own pleasure, like the prodigal son. I found this quote this week from George Bernard Shaw. He says, "This is the true joy in life, to be used for a purpose recognized by yourself as a mighty one, bigger than you, being a force of nature. Instead of complaining that the world will not devote itself to making you happy." He says, "I am of the opinion that my life belongs to the whole community, and as long as I live, it is my privilege to do for it what I can. I want to be thoroughly used up when I die." I've seen that on memes. "For the harder I work, the more I live. I rejoice in life for its own sake, because life is not a brief candle to me. It is a sort of splendid torch, which I have got a hold of just for the moment, and I want to make it burn as brightly as I can before handing it off to the future." We are created for God's creation. We are created to love God and to love our neighbors as ourselves. There is joy in that. We are created to care for our families and for those in need. We are created to glorify God. And mostly, we are created to follow Jesus and to seek to do his will in our lives. We'll talk more next week. May it be so. Amen. Our song of response is number 357. We'll do 1, 4, and 6. Please stand if you are able and let's sing. Seated. We come now to a time when we shall. Hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. We continue in prayer with our 738. God, we lift this up to you in prayer. Please do what we cannot do ourselves. We need you to break through and into our lives, our congregation, and our community. Use us together for unimagined new purposes on behalf of Christ. Break through any barriers that stand in your way and hold us back. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Now,
the addition of three children's choirs, thanks to Katie Schlotthauer, and a children's drum circle, thanks to Dennis Jones. Also, I asked and you delivered. We raised enough funds to purchase our new digital keyboard, which was put into great use over the summer and has even been featured during the services here in the sanctuary. Thank you to all of those who have made our music ministry a priority and such an important part of FUMC's identity. Whether you support it using your talents or monetary gifts, it goes a long way towards making us the music church. How music makes us feel is a very personal and intimate journey. I have been very fortunate to hear stories from many of you about how the music in this church has touched your lives in some way, strengthened your bond with God, or brought you closer to Him. My dreams for the future are to continue to get more people involved and share their talents. We will also address our aging organ in its future, so stay tuned for more information. Thank you.
All right, thanks. Thank you, Jim. Music is a huge part of this church and a huge part of our budget. It really is. I think we have one of the largest music budgets for a church this size. So again, it all depends on what you give. So I ask our ushers to come forward.
Thank you.
join me in our prayer of thanksgiving. Long-suffering God, we hear the words of the familiar parable and at different times see ourselves as either son. We have received or demanded blessings to which we are not entitled and squandered them in self-indulgent living. We have also looked out from our place of superiority and favor and have been indignant over your lavish dispensing of love and mercy. As we bring our gifts this day, we do so in the humble gratitude and recognition that any and all blessings in our life come as your gift of grace. We pray in the name of your greatest gift, Jesus, our Redeemer. Amen. Our closing song this morning is number 2197, Lord of All Hopefulness. Like a trick candle, isn't it?
These candles don't light me.
They do. There you go. At the end of the day, it's about the joy. It's about living as abundantly and as joyfully as God wants us to live, but also caring for all that needs to be cared for and thinking about our mission, which is to make disciples. So go from this place with the love of God, the fellowship of the Holy Spirit. No, that's not right. How many times do I say that? And I've just messed it up. It's the love of God, the fellowship of the Holy Spirit. No? Go with Christ. Amen.